How do I make moonshine? Well, I'm sick of them asking, so I thought I'd do a video. People keep asking me to do a video. What do I do? What do I do? How do I do this? How do I do that? So I thought I'd put it all in a video, show you what to do. So first of all, we've got corn. Now, here in the UK, we don't get corn like you get in America. So I used popcorn kernels. I'll zoom in real close on that. You can see those. Yeah, well, they're just regular popcorn kernels you get from the supermarket, untreated, nice and hard. And here we've got a glass tub, paper towels, and in here we've got some water. So first of all, what we're going to do is we're going to soak the paper towels in water so it's nice and wet, and then I'll get back to you when I've done that. Now, as you can see, you don't want to over soak the paper towels because the kernels will get too saturated. If you can, I don't know if you can see, if I've squashed down on that, you can just see my hand is, I don't know if you can see, just a tiny bit wet, just damp, nothing too overly wet, because I'll show you what to do next. I'll get back to you. What we're looking for is a nice earthy smell. Like, it's indescribable. Once you get used to doing it, once you've done it, you'll see, yeah, I know what he means. If they've gone off, it'll smell foul, they'll go purple, just discard those, they're fine, just pick them out as you see. If you see any bad ones, just pull them out so it doesn't contaminate everything else. But you're looking for a nice, like a earthy smell, like a mud smell, if that makes sense. Something, you know that it's healthy, you know that it's not gone bad or anything like that. Looking for a nice bit of growth, like I said, nice smell to it, and you'll know yourself. Experience will tell you when it's gone bad and when to. I mean, worst case scenario, you just throw it all in the bin and start again. It's not a problem. So what I'll do is I'll put this away now for a couple of weeks, and I'll get back to you with an update on how this is going. And we're done. As you can see, I've just moistened the paper towels. Make sure the paper towels are all covering the corn kernels, because they won't germinate otherwise, and they might go bad, and it's not what you want. Now, in this, we're going to cover it. Now, if you haven't got a lid like this, just put it on. You don't have to fasten it down, just put it on top like that. You can cover it with clean wrap, clean film, kitchen clean film, whatever you call it in your part of town or wherever you're from. You can cover it in that, and it'll be fine. Now you want to put this somewhere nice and warm and dry, maybe like the airing cupboard where the boiler is, somewhere where it's going to stay dry and keep the moisture in. So like I said, you cover it, and then you check it, say every week or so. If it gets, if these paper towels get dry, just give it a quick blast of water, make sure it's nice and moist in there, and after a few weeks you should get some growth on the kernels of about 2 inches, about that much, and I'll get back to you when we get cracking. Hey everyone, it's been a week, and as you can see, germination has started. You've got these nice roots coming through, and that's just about the size we're looking for. If you can see, you get two kinds of roots on it. You got this little thin one here, you get this thick one. This is the one we're looking for. You want this root to be about an inch long, so this one's about 2, so that's perfect, and they're all like that. Look, you can see that they really are quite big. And what we're going to do now, we're going to separate it from the kitchen roll, see what the others look like. If it's not favorable to use, then we'll stick them back in for another week, because some of them hasn't germinated as with it. Every seed doesn't always grow, does it? So some of them have only grown a little bit, so they might need a little bit longer. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to check them through, see if it needs to go back in for another week, as I said, about 2 weeks to go, and make sure they're all healthy, make sure they're all okay. Because look, you can see one here, zoom in a bit by a 10.8, one here's going a bit bad, can you see? Just going a little bit bad. So what you do is you just discard that, and it's perfectly fine. You just pull them ones out. It doesn't matter if you pull some others out, because you don't need those in. It's just going to contaminate everything else, and it's got a nice like earthy smell, like a soil smell. So get another blast. of that, and we'll see what it's like in another week. We're just over the second week of germination now. They're all looking like this, and what I need you to do is, I'm trying to do this one-handed here, so you just separate the root from the kernel. I know you're gonna have to do this with all of them. I know it's really laborious, it's really boring, but you hear it, it's still quite loud, it's still quite hard, should I say. But if you look there, the roots come through and the conversion from starch to sugar has taken place. So what I do is take all the roots off like that, separate them, discard them, you don't need them. I mean, you can put them in, it's not a problem, it's just not going to affect the flavour or anything. It's just I don't like doing it. They're quite wet, and I've got a mill which I'm going to show you in a second, and I don't like them going through because you need it to be quite dry, otherwise it'll not crack them up and everything, it'll just turn into a paste inside the mill and wreck it. So yeah, separate all them and they'll look just like they did before we started, but inside a change has happened and the conversion from starch to sugar has taken place, and these should be enough to get everything going. It's nice and malted now, so that's perfect, and I'll get back when the mill's set up. As you can see, I've separated all the roots from the kernels, and what we're going to do, well, what you want to do is you want to put these in a bowl, set them to one side for a couple of days, about 2 days if you can, put them in the sun, give them a couple of days to just dry off, and then show you what we'll do next. It's been a couple of days now, they're nice and dry, they've been in the sun for the last few days, even though we've not had much sun, but they've been drying out, been settling down. It gives it a chance to, if you miss any roots on there, this gives them roots to dry up before we go through the mill. And what the mill is, I bought one of these cool little contraptions. I mean, look at that, that's awesome. It just sits on the desk there, it gets flaky, little bits coming out of it from the last run. You put your handle in like that, and what that does is you put your, try not to hit myself, you put your grain in there, and you turn the handle like that, and it crushes. Sends it all through there. Try and get it, and you adjust it with these and with these wing nuts, and it goes through there. And try and pop this off for you. I can't get it off. But yeah, it just, try and see if I can now. Can't get it off. It's stuck on. But you can see, it just, what you've got in there. If you see, you can see that perfect. You've just got these two crushing mechanisms, I think the best word to describe it is, these two crushing wheels that will just smash, there it is, that will just smash the grain together. If you see, one's going one way and one stays put, and it just smashes the grain up together and turns it into a nice grain, you know, like a flour, I suppose. If you did it hard enough, you'd get flour. So I'll come back in a moment, I'll show you what to do. Right, the grain's in, I've got the collection tub at the back there. I'm just going to turn this around and hopefully it'll work well enough to show you what to do. If you can see, it all comes out at the bottom there. And I'll get back to this where I can use both hands and I'll show you what the final thing is. And we're back, I'm out of breath now, that's not an easy job. But as you can see, it's smashed up the grain, the malt, smashed it up into pretty much like a powder or like a coarse, like cornmeal, I suppose. But yeah, you can put that through again if you want to, which I'm going to, because it's not as smashed up as I like to. Like it, I'd rather run it through twice and put it on really tight. You'll never turn the handle. It's really hard work. I'm literally out of breath by turning it. You'll get a good workout out of it anyway. So I'll come back and I'll put this through again and I'll show you what it looks like after that. Just to show you what the inside is going through, I'll hit myself. Sorry for the noise, it's quite noisy and it's quite messy as well, so make sure your collection tub's at the back as it is there. This is the second one we're doing. It literally goes everywhere, but you can tidy that off afterwards, it's not a problem. That'll just work its way through there, through the two smashing stones, smash it all together, and it'll come out like that, which is fine, it's totally usable. We're going to cook that anyway, so it's not a problem, and I'll get back to you when we're on the recipe stage or when I finish this bit. And we're back. I've tied it up, get all the bits off the side. I've still got some bits left, I'll get that in a moment. Yeah, it's a nice coarse material. Now you can use popping corn for the whole entire recipe if you wanted to. You just run it through the mill. This is the mill. If you can see them two wheels I tried showing you before, and when you turn that, it just smashes the grain together, and it just courses it all up and grinds it all up. Now this cost me £35. It's really, really good. Nice and sturdy, solid material. And if you leave a comment or whatever, I'll show you what website I got all this stuff from. And obviously I can't advertise it on here, I'll get in trouble, but yeah, I'll tell you everything. If you've got any questions, just hit the comment section below. But yeah, going back to this, you can use the mill to do the entire recipe if you want. Now my recipe is going to be 80% corn, 10% barley and 8% rye. Now fortunately, I don't know about you guys, but I was into brewing beer, and I've got some malted barley left over, so I'm going to use that. I'll show you what that looks like in another, when I come back. And I've got I bought off another website, which I'll tell you if you ask, I'll tell you where I got it all from. And now I got your grains, whole grains, where you can just buy them, organic whole grains in the UK. How awesome is that? So yeah, I'm using 8% rye, 10% barley and 82% corn. Now the more barley you use, the more smoother end product you've got, and the more rye you use, the more bite the end product's got. So what you could do is, when you get used to doing it, you can mix and match however you want to do it. You could put more barley in, more rye in. You could just do 100% barley, do a scotch. You can buy peated barley. You could buy, just do a complete rye mix. You could just do complete corn. It's totally up to you. However you want to do it, there's no wrong way or right way about it. You can do whatever you want to do, put in whatever you want to put in. The process is still the same, but the end product is completely different, and it depends what product you're wanting to go for. Now what I recommend you do, write down everything that you do, every single step that you do, write it down, document it with yourself. So then if you produce a really nice whiskey at the end, really nice bit of moonshine, you can know exactly what you've done. You won't be thinking, scratching your head, oh my god, what did I do, that was awesome, that one, I can never make it again. You know what you've done in the process, you know what to do in the stilling stage. But yeah, the malting of the corn, you don't necessarily need to do that. You can buy things like Amy Lace, which I've got, I'll show you what that looks like. You don't have to do the malted corn. You can get chemicals these days that converts the starches to sugar. Me, I like doing things to the traditional way, the way things people had it in the woods and stuff like that. They didn't really have chemicals and stuff like that, which is just for our convenience, which is awesome to use. There's no wrong way about it, as long as the process is pretty much the same. The end product is completely different depending on what you've done. This is the Amy Lace. I don't know if you can see that. I'll try and plug up the... Yeah, you just use one teaspoon per 4.5 litres to remove the starch. That'll convert all your starches over to sugar. It only costs that much. And that just looks, it's like a powder. I've not got much of that left. I have used it in the past. I've done it this way. I've done things completely, every single which way but loose, I've done it. This is just the best method. I prefer the conventional method like this. I've made it with the chemicals, I made it without the chemicals. I prefer this. I've done it 100% corn kernels. I've done it 100% cornmeal. I've put raisins in it, everything mixed through, everything what you could possibly think of, I've put it in the moonshine. This is the best one. I personally, my palate's different to yours. This is what I personally like to drink. This is how I personally like to make things. And what I'm going to do with this is, I'm not sure if I'm going to use cornmeal or sweet corn yet. It doesn't matter. You could use sweet corn. If you use the best ingredients, then obviously you're going to get the better end product. So if you are going to use frozen sweet corn, try and get the super sweet corn. They pick it at like the milking stage in the corn plant. It's got the highest sugar content, so obviously it's going to be even better because it's residual sugars that can get converted over to alcohol in the end process. And
the more alcohol in the end product, the more alcohol we've got in our glass at the end of the day. So yeah, what I'll do is I'll get back and I'll show you exactly what I'm putting it in. I'll show every single step that I do, and if you've got any questions, just leave a comment and I'll see if I can help. So what you want to do is you can bag this up till you're ready to go with your recipe. It'll last, it's nice and dry, so it'll last until you're ready to go. I'll show you how to cook it in at the right temperatures and everything. But yeah, one thing I'd noticed, I was bagging it up then and I'd licked my fingers to separate the bags. And it got a nice sweet taste on my fingers. It's already converted the starch to sugars. You can taste that when, because I was picking off the roots with my fingers, I've got all like a sugary residue sweet flavour on my fingers. I just thought I'd tell you that, you know, that's what I mean, the conversion from starch to sugars is already taking place, and these will be a good thing to get us going on the converting the rest of the starches and the other grains that we're going to use into sugars, which then obviously can be converted to alcohol. And I'll talk you through when at that stage when we come to like pitching the yeast, what yeast to use, and I'll show you what I've always done. What's in front of me here is just the recipe what I use to make my moonshine. I know in a previous part of the video I said only use super sweet corn. I tried to get it at the supermarket, they just literally didn't have it. So this one's fine. It's the frozen for freshness, really good, tastes really good on your plate as well. It's really nice, nothing wrong with it. I'd stay away from like the really cheap kind. If it's not really nice to eat, it's not really going to make a nice drink flavor at the end of it. You can use cornmeal, perfectly fine. Anything to do with corn is perfectly fine. But yeah, that's the sweet corn. That's the sugar. This is a 5 kilogram bag. I picked this up for about £2.80. I use an extra kilo on that, so I'll be using 6 kilos of that. I'm going to use 3.6 kilos of corn, because these are 1 kilo bags, so we've got the 600 grams of corn. I forget how much it was, but yeah, we're going to use 3 kilos of corn plus the malted corn, so that's all counts as corn. I've got the rye grain here. I'm going to use 500 grams of this. That's whole rye grain. That's organically grown, so it's not really good, really good, a good grain. I've got barley grain here. That's, as you can see, that's whole grains there. And you can malt this, similar process to what I did with the corn at the beginning of the video. You can do the same process. It will germinate. I've tried it. It's really difficult to do. It's not for me personally. It's just too much like hard work to malt the barley. It's perfectly fine. Now I've got this all left over from a beer I once did. I forget how long ago now. But yeah, it was just malted barley. It's already pre-malted for me. As you can see, it's already partly smashed up as well. So you won't need to put this through the mill. You know, that's already done for you. You can buy these from any good brewing store. You struggle with the maize. It's really expensive, I think, for flaked maize, which is pretty much just crushed corn, like what we've done at the beginning of the video. God, I think I was paying something like £3 for 500 grams. It really was expensive. Like I said, it's just easier to get this, or you can use the corn kernels. You can buy them in big 5 kilo bags like this. Well, like this one, should I say. You can grind it all up yourself, you can malt it, you can do what you like, or you can use sweet corn, or you can use cracked corn from local supermarket, which is cornmeal. It's already pre-ground up for you, as you're probably already well aware watching this video. You know what you're doing. The best before date, I think, is gone out of date on this one, but it doesn't show any signs of going off or anything like that, so I'm still going to use that. I've got too much there to throw away. I've not made any moonshine for a little bit, so I think I better pull my socks up and start making some. But yeah, like I said, I'm using 500 grams of rye. I'm going to use 600 grams of barley. I might just use this, which is the malted barley, just to get rid of it. I'm going to use 6 kilos of this, 3 kilos plus of corn, and yeast. Now, you'll find everywhere people's opinions on yeast is different. People say you must use distiller's yeast, you must use champagne yeast, cider yeast, beer yeast, ale yeast. You know, they're all pretty much fine. They're all fine. People say you have to use this stuff, which is a turbo yeast, which is perfectly fine. That'll get you a really good yield of alcohol. It says there you can use 6 kilos, 7 kilos, and it'll perfectly do that perfectly fine. Those are fine. I think something like that will cost you £3 to £4. But I don't use that. I use that if I'm making a vodka, which I use on the reflux still, because obviously it doesn't give you any off flavours, which you actually want in the final product. When you use, I'll show you the yeast I use. I use this, which is dried active bread yeast. As you can hear, it just looks like regular yeast. I've got one open here, actually. I'll show you what it looks like on the inside. Just pop the lid off. That's what it looks like on the inside. It's like regular yeast. You get that for 60p at the local supermarket. But what it doesn't have is the yeast nutrients. So you can buy these, which are yeast nutrients, which is, you just put, let me just have a quick read. You just put 1 round teaspoon per gallon. So, you know, however many gallons you use. And my still's 25 litres, so that's just over 5 gallons. I use 5 teaspoons per the full mixture at the end products, which I'll talk you through when we get to that point. But what I'm saying is these yeasts are fine. If you've got them, use them. I save these for making vodka because you don't get any off flavours as you do with this, but you want the off flavours. You want your whiskey to be unique. And when I say off flavours, I mean, if anyone's ever made bread and you activate this yeast, it smells like a nice beer anyway, you know, and that's what you're looking for. You're looking for a distiller's beer. That's what some people call it. And that's pretty much what we're making with these grains. We're making a nice distiller's beer, which we're going to obviously distill into a moonshine whiskey, which is fine. Well, like I said, these, we've got to go through the mill. If you've got one, great. If you've not got one, you can buy them like this, pre-milled for you. Cost you a bit more expense, a bit more than what it would to buy something like this. I think a pack like this costs you something like £5, you know, plus delivery. You know, if you buy it in bulk, obviously, you know, you're going to save a fortune on delivery, because they are quite heavy. But like I said, you know, this is what we're doing, just to go through it again. Put these through the mill. I'll get back to you when I've done that. I'm not going to use that this time. I'm going to use this. But like I said, if you want to make a scotch or anything like that, you can buy from online brewing shops. You can buy peated barley. You can buy it in like the 25 kilo sack fulls. But I stick to the lower ones. I don't make it that often. I make it when I need it. I drink it myself. I don't sell it or anything. It's just a hobby of mine. Like I said, this is actually best before. It's not showing any signs of going off. It's not gone foul or anything like that. If it had, I'd just throw it out. It's cheap enough. I'm not eating it. I'm drinking it, essentially. So yeah, I'll get back to you when I've ground all that up, and I'll show you what it looks like. I get to mention just quickly that when you're using the yeast, I use a full tin of this. It's 125 grams. You can use the turbo yeast there quick. That's 110 grams, and inside there is just, sorry if it's a bit mucky, it's been in the cupboard for a while, yeast nutrients and other things. Like I said, I'm going to add the yeast nutrients myself. It just runs cheaper, and for me, I get a much better yield, and this has got no worries to converting all the sugars to alcohol. I get a really good yield at the end of it. I'll show you. I don't usually use a hydrometer when I'm doing this. I don't feel the need to, but I will do for the purpose of the video. I'll show you that the yeast, the bread yeast that I'm using, will convert it all over to alcohol, no worries. This is what 500 grams of rye looks like. It's just in a bowl. If you look, it's just really hard. Really, it feels like rice, I imagine. That's the best description. It's really hard, really a hardy crop. It's really good, and not that it matters, but that's organic. I suppose if you want to say you're making organic moonshine, I suppose you could. But yeah, we're just going to mash that through the mill, and I'll show you what it looks like afterwards. Back, I've got a big massive pan here. This is a 15 litre pan, and that'll big enough to cook all your mash, even if you need to do it in two parts, but it's pretty big there. This is the fermenting bucket I've got. I've marked off, that's coming up a bit, but I marked off where the increments are for approximately how big it is. It's about a 60 litre drum, this. I've melted the sugar last night. As you can see, it's inside. What I like to do is I like to melt it, dissolve it, should I say. It took it full right up to the top in here. Let it cool overnight and pour it in, because you don't want to be pouring hot sugary water everywhere. You get one splash of that on your skin and it's going to really burn for quite some time. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get on to cooking the mash now, and then I'll show you when to add the malt and what to do on that. And obviously, you know, if you guys are making moonshine, you've done this before, or you're just getting into it, make sure everything's nice and sterile, and everything's nice and clean. Everything that touches the inside of this bucket has to be sterilised first. Make sure it's all nice and sorted. I've got a nice stone chopping board, so I can just take this off the cooker, and it's really heavy because you've got 6 kilos of sugar plus, you know, it's however amount of water's going in there, so it is quite heavy. So I just left this overnight on this. It's not going to burn nice work surfaces or anything like that, so I'm not going to get told off, should I say. And so I'll get back to cooking the mash. I'll show you what to do after that. As you can see, I've got my barley in here, and I've got my rye in here. I'm cooking it separate from the corn because I'm using sweet corn. If I'd have used cornmeal, it wouldn't have made a difference. I'd have just put it all in the same pan, but because I'm using frozen sweet corn for this run, I thought I've liquidized that. I'm going to show you what I'm doing in a moment with that. I've liquidized that. I'm cooking it in a separate pan, but because this barley and this rye is like hardened grains, proper grains, are going to need a lot of cooking through, and already it's turning like a thick gloopy porridge, you know, which is what we want really. We just want to put that, I've had that under a gentle heat now for about 20 minutes, and it's nice, like a nice warm bath temperature. I'm going to try and keep it at that temperature for about, I don't know, until I get the right consistency. I'll show you what consistency. You're looking for a nice gloopy porridge, and then just thin it down with your wooden spoon. I'm using a non-stick pan, you know, for this, because it does get sticky. That's releasing all the starches, which obviously we're going to convert to sugars, and convert them sugars over to alcohol with the yeast. So I've not put my malt in yet. You have to put that in at the right temperature, and I'll show you what to do with that at a later stage. See, it's in my big giant pan, and it comes up to about there, just off the lid. Is it the consistency I want? I've been cooking it for about 20 minutes now. It smells amazing. It really does. So if you like sweet corn, it's like sweet corn heaven. It just smells amazing. This isn't a non-stick pan, so obviously, you know, keep an eye on it, babysit it, put it under a gentle heat, cook it at a nice constant temperature. But if it sticks, you'll have a lot of cleaning up to do afterwards, which, you know, it's a pain in the backside doing. But yeah, this smells amazing. I've liquidised it in a blender, which was a pain in the backside doing. And if you look, it's at a nice consistency. It's just like a porridge, basically, a runny porridge. That's what we're looking for. And when the stage comes to add the barley and the rye, I'll add that. I'm cooking that in a separate pan. That's just here with the lid on at the moment. That's resting nicely. As it absorbs the water, I can't carry on adding water until it's at the consistency I want. I want to make sure all that's, I've not got big giant lumps, what I haven't broken down or anything like that. I don't know if you guys have ever made porridge before, but if you don't make it properly, you'll have a lumpy porridge. That's not what we want. We want a nice consistency like that. And I'm gonna add the malt at the right temperature. You have to put it in a specific temperature, otherwise you'll kill all the enzymes in there. We don't want to do that, otherwise it won't convert to the starch to sugars. It'll be fine. Like I said, you don't have to do the malt corn, you don't have to use the chemicals to convert it over. You just convert your sugar, which I put 6 kilos in. That'll give us a nice alcohol yield, and it'll just taste like a corn, barley and rye porridge soup, basically, which I suppose the end result, you do want it to ascertain some of those flavours anyway, because all these flavours are going to come out in the final product, and you'll be amazed what final product you can get. I just wish it was smell-o-vision, because it just smells amazing. So I'll continue cooking this for a little bit longer, and I'll get back to you when I'm at the next process. This has been cooking pardon me, this has been cooking for a while now. You want to get it to about 155 Fahrenheit. I don't know if you can see that, it's built upside down. It's currently hitting 123, 125. When it hits 150, I've only got it on a really low light, and that's the best way to cook it. Low and slow, cook it on a low light. When it hits 150, I'm going to add in the malt. And then obviously it's only going to work between 150 and 165 degrees Fahrenheit. Otherwise it'll just kill it all off. So I'll get back when it comes to that temperature. Added the barley and the rye. It was really soft and squidgy and dead thick. You can tell that when I can't drop the spoon, when you put it in your fingers and tap it together, you see all the gloopiness, like porridge goes in between your fingers. So I just added it to the corn. I've just took a temperature reading a second ago, it was 125, so I'm going to put this back on a low light now and keep it there and simmer it until it gets to the temperature I want, and then I'll add the malt, and then those enzymes should go to work perfect. Just taking another reading, I'm just taking it off the stove now so I can control the temperature a bit better. It's just creeping up to 150, slowly rising. It's at 136, so I'm going to put this back on the stove, probably just let it creep up, see what it comes to. Yeah, it's still on the rise. I really want to keep control of the temperature, so you want to do this slowly. Stopping at 137.7, so I'm going to put this back on the heat, give it a little bit more heat underneath it, see if I can just gradually rise it slowly. Like I said, if I heat it up too much, you can always take it off, and then you just want to make sure you want to add the malt enzymes to the mix at 150 degrees, because you put it in when it's over, it's just going to be just going to kill the enzymes, and it's just going to all be for nothing. It'll still taste nice, but you just won't get that conversion of starches, which is a big shame. So I'll get back when I put this on the heat. As you can see, it's really close to 150, so I'm going to take this off the heat now. I'm going to let it chill, see what it comes up to, and then let it settle, get it to 150. Once it settles at 150, I'll add the enzymes, which I'm going to do now. Just poured the malt enzymes on what I crushed up earlier, and the other day actually, and excuse me, yeah, I'm just stirring that in now. I've took that off the heat, it's on my chopping board now, where it'll stay until it cools down, and that'll convert all the starches to sugars. And if you're using amylase, I think you need the amylase alpha and beta. You'll have to look into that. I've never used the amylase myself. I've always gone the malt way. I just prefer it's easier for me. And yeah, one other quick thing. After this, you can strain it and then put the juice, the liquid, into your fermenting barrel. But as you can see, the sugar itself just comes over 10 litres, and my still is 25. So, excuse me, if you want to, you can just tip this into the bucket. But you have to understand that it's going to come... I've got enough hands. It's going to come to about here with all the ingredients in. So just remember to top it up accordingly, because you want to make sure you've got 25 litres of liquid going into your still, however big your still is. This is just for my recipe, and my still, obviously, you know you're on stills. If it's a larger still, you want to make sure your still's filled up to the maximum. Obviously, you know, you're not going to get enough alcohol yield if it's not filled up properly. So I'll let this settle, keep stirring it, and I'll come back and check on it later. But as you can see, it's like a nice porridge. Everything's together, and that's perfect. It smells amazing, by the way. You know, I don't know if you like sweet corn and stuff like that, but it really does smell nice. And obviously, good ingredients going in. good product coming out. That's the way I see things. An hour now, and the starch conversion to sugar has already started to take place. If you can see, it's really gone really watery on the top, and it's gone really watery inside. As you can see, it's no longer thick and gloopy. It's nice and runny, because obviously the starch molecules is what naturally make it gloopy, and when they break down and turn to sugar molecules, it no longer has the consistency of like a glue, you know. So I'm going to leave this overnight. I could put that in the barrel in the bucket now and let it go all night, but it still feels warm on the side, so I'm just gonna let that calm down, let it do its thing without interrupting it or anything. I'm just gonna put a lid on it, come back tomorrow, and it'll be nice in room temperature, because obviously I can't pitch my yeast until it gets to room temperature anyway. So if I whack this in, it's just gonna be too high and kill all my yeast. So like I said, I was saying before, when we put, I'm not gonna strain this off, I never have done. I'm gonna pour this all into here, and that's the sugar in there dissolved in water. This alone is going to come to about here, so it's probably going to come to about here with them both on, and then I'm gonna let that settle off, so probably leave it another night after that. So it's two nights from now, just probably going to come to about down. It'll all settle down, and then I'm going to top it up with water till I'll count off here 25 liters on top of that, mix it all up, and then I'll I don't usually do this, but I'll take a original gravity reading just to show the video what the conversion's like with the type of yeast I'm using, because a lot of people say don't use baker's yeast, don't do this, don't do that. Listen, there's no right way or wrong way about doing this. As long as you're safe, and as long as you dispose the first four shots what contain all the methanol, as long as you don't use anything that's got any type of lead or plastic or anything like that that's going to touch the alcohol vapor, there's no way of going wrong. You just turn, what you could do is, you make a mistake, you just make rubbish moonshine, you just re-still it or throw it away. What's the worst that could happen? You throw it away, it tastes like crap. This stuff I've been tasting for years. I sip it, it's really nice, I enjoy it. There's no reason why, if you're safe, like I said, there's no reason why you can't enjoy a good hobby. You can just enjoy making moonshine and drink it yourself. You don't have to sell it. You can just enjoy the process yourself. There's nothing wrong with it. So like I said, I'll talk to you about that at a later stage when I need to. And yeah, I'm going to dump this in there, top it up to, my still was about 25, 30 litres. And so I'm going to top that up with water, so it gets to that. So it'll probably come to about here, like I said, top it up 25 litres on these increments, not very neatly done, but I've borrowed the missus' nail varnish as a secret. So yeah, top it up to 25 litres, and then it will all ferment off, and we'll pour that in the still and still it. So I'll talk to you about that when we get to that stage. Poured all the water in, I've just poured all the mash into the sugar in the barrel. That's what it looks like. I'm gonna let this settle now, probably overnight, so then I can pretty much just see how much water to top it up to get my 25-30 litre mark, because I want to make sure my still's nice and full. Because what's gonna happen is, all this is gonna settle to the bottom, and then it's gonna separate from the water. Obviously, you know, this is going to keep its nice flavour and colour. Like I said, you could take this out, strain it through a bag, something like that. I think it's too much like hard work. I'd rather do that afterwards, separate the liquid from the grain we've got in there. And what I'll do is, I'll top it up to, when I know how much I need to do, top it up till. I'll take an original gravity reading, and I'll take a final gravity reading for you, and I'll show you what it, how much the yeast converts over. So when I get round to pitching the yeast, I'll start the video again. I've left it overnight. I've got a bit of growth on top, activated yeast, so that's natural yeast in there. If I left that, it would ferment all the alcohol, but obviously, you know, it'd be better, you know, end product, because you get less of off flavours. But obviously I'm going to add yeast to it. I left that overnight. I'm just topping it up to 25 litres now because that's what we've got, what we're looking to achieve. I'm going to mix that up and then I'll take the gravity reading. Just finished topping it off now. I've got a torch because unfortunately my bucket isn't see-through. Just shine it on the inside. That's all the mash at the bottom. I'm going to mix it up again in a minute. I've just let it settle overnight. I've topped it up to 25 litres and I'll show you how I did that. Because if you look there, it's just above the 10. So you go up another 5, 10, 15, 20, about 25-ish, just over. 25 litres, that's what I'm aiming for because that's what's going to fill up my still. I'm going to mix all this up one more time, then I'm going to come back and pitch my yeast because it's all nice room temperature now. I don't know if you can see it. See that, what am I looking at? At 20 degrees, I don't know if you can just see that there. I'll check one down here. Well, it's not picking up very well on the camera, but I can see that the 20 degrees is it's just changed colour, so that's what temperature it is inside the bucket. It's nice and room temperature. I've got a little bit of activation going on already. That's from the malt. That's how I know that the enzymes have worked inside. That conversion's all, that's just natural yeast that's present in the enzymes and stuff like that, what's in the air and stuff. It's already started activating overnight. I'm going to pitch my yeast and then mix it up and then cap it off with a bubbler. I'll show you what I'm doing in a second. I don't usually do this, but pardon me, for the purpose of the video, I thought I'd get my hydrometer out. I don't know if you can see that very well. It's just, God, excuse me on this. It's just sitting at the 1.070. If you look with water dispersion, it's just sitting there. And if that can, obviously once that's converted, I don't know if you guys have made beer before. I don't usually make it anymore, but this is what you do to work out the alcohol content. But it just shows that there's a lot of sugar in that liquid that we've got in the bucket now. And that's the kind of colour you're looking for. It's like a nice yellow, high corn content. Like I said, depending on your recipe, you can put what you want in it. But it smells really nice. It just smells of super sweet corn. Really, really nice sweet flavour because there's a lot of sugar in there, obviously. And what I recommend you do is have a taste. Get used to the flavours. It might taste like crap, but it probably tastes just like sugary sweet corn, you know. But if that fermented down, have a taste again. And, you know, this is the scientific way to find out when all your sugars are converted to alcohol and there's no more sugars left in the liquid. You can go old school and just taste it. And when it tastes bitter, you know that it's converted over then, because obviously once the sweetness is gone, all the sugar's gone, so obviously it's going to taste bitter. It'll just taste like a corn, barley and rye beer, basically. And some people, depending on which part of the world you come from, call that distiller's beer. I think some parts of Scotland call that. But anyway, I'm going to pitch the yeast now and I'll get back to you. I thought I'd just quickly show you what it looks like on the inside when we've topped it up to 25 litres of water. Obviously, we've got about 39, just under 40 litres of the barrel filled up, the bucket filled up. But obviously, you know, we know that just over 12 of those notches are catered for the mash, because I don't fancy straining it out. But obviously, if you're straining it out, that's fine. You still want to end up with about 25 litres of liquid, of fermentable liquid in the bucket, because obviously my still is about 25 litres. I could probably fit a bit more in, but I don't like going over the maximum line. But I always aim for the minimum to be the maximum. I never aim under. I don't bother setting the still up if it's going to be less, because you just get less of an alcohol yield at the end of it. And it makes for better cuts when you're making your cuts in the stilling process. So I'm just giving this a good mix up and I'm gonna get ready to put my yeast nutrients in and pitch my yeast as well. You'll have to excuse me, I'm trying to tidy up as I go along. I've just mixed up the mash and I'm just getting sugar water everywhere, so I'll have to give it a good clean in a second. Now I took some liquid out of the mash, I'll put it in a little cup. And what I'm going to do is, if you remember the yeast nutrients I've got, It requires 1 level teaspoon per gallon. I've got 25 litres, that's 5 gallons, 5 litres to the gallon, that's 5 times 5 is 25. So that's 5 teaspoons for me, and I'm just going to tip this in here, mix it up. I'm trying to do it one-handed, bear with me. I apologise if I'm in the way. Try not to breathe in the dust, I'm sure it's not good for you. But yeah, just mix it in a bit of the liquid outside of it. It dissolves pretty well, but I'd rather do it in a little cup like this. As you can see, it just dissolves pretty well, and that gives you the nutrients for the yeast, which is what you get in the turbo yeast. Like I said, I do prefer, you can use whichever yeast you're going for. I'm not going to get into that with you. Like I said, there's no right way or wrong way about this. This is just, I'm just showing you guys what I do and what methods I use. So I'll just set that to one side, and I then tip that in there. Just get all the dregs out of the cup, and I'm going to pitch my yeast now. I've opened the lid. As I was talking to you about yeast before, I use the dried active yeast with the yeast nutrients. Now you can get other varieties of this one, Easy Bake and stuff. I use this for when I'm baking bread. I'm trying to open it one-handed, so I might look at where. If you look, all pretty much the same. It all looks the same. Sure, it'll do a good job. I'm sure it'll ferment, but I tend to use this one. This is one I've always used. I found this to get good results, so I'll stick to what I know. So I'm just gonna sprinkle that all around like that until it's gone. I'm gonna get my getting it all over myself. Now sugar water everywhere. Just get my paddle, and what I do is I give it a good mix round. One final mix, make sure the the yeast is all covered in the mash. It's all nice and wet. Get it from the sides and stuff. Just trying to show you what I'm doing there. It smells really nice, to be fair. It just smells like a really rich, nice and sweet corn. So yeah, just try and mix that through, give it a good mix. And then what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put the lid on, leave that 10 minutes. And then I'm going to open it up and give it another mix, because by then you should get a nice, a nice activation on the top, a nice foam on the top where the yeast is all started, because as soon as it reacts with the sugar, it's all gonna start working. And just try and break up the lumps that form. So you just break that up. I'll be better doing this two-handed, so I'm going to stop the video. I'll do this, and I'll get back in 10 minutes when it's activated. Well, it's been 10 minutes. I'm going to open it up inside. Oh yeah, that looks pretty cool. I'm just going to do this lid. That's what we're looking for, a nice indication that the yeast is activated. That's fine, so give it one last stir. Get all the bits from the side. Try and do this one-handed. Give it one last stir. I'll put a bubbler in the lid, and we're gonna seal it up in a second, and gonna shift all the sediment from the bottom, or the mash from the bottom, get it all nice and mixed up for the last time, because we're gonna leave this shut now for about 5 days to a week until it stops bubbling. I'm gonna cap this off, and then I'll see you in 5 days when we take it off, see what it looks like. everyone, sorry about the last video. I don't know what happened with the audio. Hopefully it's sorted now. Yeah, I've got my washing here. I've got my temperature in there. I've got my copper dome on, condensing arm on. I'm gonna put some distiller's paste on everywhere where I think it needs it. Don't need to put it on there, but I will anyway. This is a condensing arm. It goes all the way through there. I bypass this condensing bit. I don't use that. I'd rather just use the two. That's just where you just do the one distillation and then you save it for a spirits run, and then you put it back in the still, and then you distill it again. So it's basically just doing two distillations two separate times. I'd rather just do it at once. So I bypass this. I don't use this. I use this copper arm, which I made. And it's got those cuts in it, and it, if you notice, it's I've cut it where it's not level, and that, so when it sits in the thumper, the doubler, one side doesn't sit on the floor at the bottom, and it allows for good flow of vapor. Now you have to pardon my thump keg, it's an old aging barrel which I didn't like. I'll talk to you about the aging. I used to age my moonshine in this. I didn't like it, so I just thought I'd try using it as a thumper. It's new territory for me, I've never done it before. So yeah, that sits in there. I've got water in it at the moment to swell it out, make sure it's not leak, make sure it's leak proof and there's no leaks. Yeah, so that sits in there. I put distiller's paste here, distiller's paste there, which I'm going to connect the two. That just sits in there nicely like that. Distiller's paste right now, which will dry rock solid when it gets hard. This other copper pipe, sorry I can't see, goes in there. Now this pipe has to go to the floor where inside here I use tails from a previous run. I'll see if I can just grab those down quick. I use tails from a previous run. Now you can tell the tails because it's a bit clear. Sorry if the jar's dirty, I've not used it in about 12 months. I've kind of like just hid it away in the shed. Now that's about 50% alcohol in there. It smells of just like sweet liquor. You know it's tails because it's cloudy. That's how you know it's tails. You don't want that. But I always saved that from my previous run and put it in here. Now I've got a few jars of that, so it'll fill it up to about here. This pipe goes in, submerges in the water. Now this inlet pipe has to be submerged. Make sure that's submerged. Because it was an aging barrel, it came with a bung. I just put some wood glue on that. That's fine. It's not coming into contact with the liquor. I put an elastic band on there for safety precautions. You can't be too safe. Now this, let's move that. It's filled up with water, isn't it? It's heavy. With this, I made myself. This goes from the thumper to the condensing pipe. Now I made it myself. It doesn't look pretty, but soldered it myself. Every joint is all soldered, but it works. It's all sealed. Now you have to use lead-free solder. Cannot stress that enough. Must use lead-free solder. And if you're going to use stainless steel, make sure it's good quality stainless steel and none of that Chinese crap. Pardon my French. Pardon me, I'm losing my voice today. Make sure it's none of that Chinese rubbish, cheap stuff. It has to be good quality stainless steel and it has to be copper. No aluminium, no nothing. Just don't do it. It's not worth your health. It is high percentage, high vapor, high octane alcohol vapor you're dealing with here. No rubber, no adhesives, no nothing. Like I said, that doesn't come into contact with the vapor. It just comes straight out of here into the pipe, into the condensing pipe, and then out into the jar. Yeah, like I said, that is about, I don't know if you can see, it's about a half an inch thick, the wood on that. So that, it secured it anyway. It was leak proof because obviously it was there to store liquids, but I didn't trust it because you're dealing with high pressure vapor, you know. I didn't trust it, so I thought I'd glue it on with some PVA glue, which is nice and solid, that's not going nowhere. Put an elastic band on for extra safety measures. Distiller's paste there, distiller's paste there, here, and obviously going to the condensing pipe as well. It'll all support its own weight, like I said, that'll sit on there, that'll go in there nicely. Got water in there in a minute, so it's going everywhere. Like I said, when that's on the floor, my new wire. Sorry if I'm spinning you around. If you see, allows perfect circulation of vapour. So hopefully there'll be no more problems with my audio. I'll tidy up this mess now I've just made. I'll try and get a video of my stool operating. You do want to babysit these things. You know, you are dealing with alcohol here. You know, any mishaps what come along the way, it does come along the way, you're always on hand to sort out any leaks. Paper towel, distiller's paste, it's fine, which is just rye flour and water mixed together to make a paste, you know, so that'll be easy to do. You put that on every single that bits there. See, this is held down to the stool with those latchings there and there and around the back as well, so I've not got no worries about this coming off. I've used this stool plenty of times. I always get a good run off this. This is just something I've always done. I'm just showing you you guys for the video. I've never used this before. I'm interested to see what kind of results I get off this. I don't even know if it's going to work or not, so I'm a bit apprehensive of using it, which is why I took the extra safety precautions on using the PVA glue and gluing it in. But like I said, it's that thick wood. The glue is only on the outside, so it doesn't come into contact with the vapor. And inside here, it was charred because I used to age moonshine in it. But I'll get to the, I'll talk to you about that at the end of the distilling process when we get the moonshine out and the liquor and we're all waiting. I'll talk to you about aging and everything. And like I said, I made this pipe pretty cheap to do. Just stay away from anything that's got any metals in it, any lead. You only want to use copper's perfect. Only stainless steel if you want to use it. This is stainless steel, good quality stainless steel. Sorry for the, needs a bit of a clean on the outside, but good quality stainless steel, none of that Chinese rubbish. This still cost me a fortune. So did the copper dome, so did the arm. You know, I made these bits and bobs myself to bypass that condensing tube. All cheap as chips. Like I said, just stay away from anything with lead in it or anything like that. It's not worth the risk. You know, you're making this alcohol yourself to enjoy, not to poison yourself. It's not worth the hassle. So I'll get back to you when I've finished the distilling process, and hopefully I won't have any more problems with the audio. If I do, I'll just write it in the description what you need to do. And if you've got any questions, just give us a shout. And like I said, when we finish, I'll talk to you about the collecting the tails at the end of the run. I'll show you how to separate the four shots, the heads, the hearts and the tails. And Popcorn Sutton always used to say, save the tails, last bits of the last run, use it in the thumper, not a problem. So it's just something I adopted from that, and I've always got good results from that. And plus there's 50%, about 49% alcohol in that. I've got a few more jars of these. I've just kept them in the shed, put them away for cold storage. It's perfectly fine. That's a steel lid, that is not aluminium or anything like that. So you just dump that back in here and that'll just redistill through, and that'll go into your next run, which is fine. And I'll get back to you when I finish the process, and I'll talk to you more about what to cut, when to cut it, what percentage it'll be, and what I do. Like I said, this video is just what I do. There's thousands of videos out there that people will be saying, you're using the wrong still, you shouldn't do this, you shouldn't do that, you shouldn't do this. Listen, this is just what I do safely for my own hobby. You know, I'm not hurting anybody. I drink this myself, I enjoy this myself. It's something I've always loved to do. The only reason I'm making this video is because people keep asking me what the process is. baby steps, step by step in between. If I said to you, I make whiskey, oh, how do you do that? Well, it's not just in a nutshell, you know, it's a long process. So if I do this video to make sure that I document everything, what I do, how I've done it, how I've always done it for many years, and how I'll continue to do so, you know. I've never hurt anybody, you know, I've never hurt myself because I've stuck away from lead solder. I always have to have lead-free solder. I've not used any cheap materials. I've not used any cheap steel. I always use the best spun copper piping. You know, I've always used the best materials to have the best equipment, because you don't want to get cheap stills from China that will just make alcohol and you'll be thinking it's fine. These heavy metals are undetectable, you know, so you're drinking it and your body hasn't got a way of disposing of these heavy metals, so they just stay in your body and it poisons you. It's not good for you. Just stay away from cheap stills. Like I said, this is wood, food grade wood. I've drank whiskey out of this. You can put water in that and drink it, it's fine. I blended it all together, and we've got just under 3 litres of liquor, and it's just at 59%. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pour it back into my demijohn. Now, aging options, you can either get a barrel like this, which I didn't like, the charred inside and the fine, if you like. What I did, I had another barrel and I cut off the oak wood lid and I made some aging sticks. Not pretty, but they'll work. I've medium charred them. And one stick should do. You can buy these, obviously a bit more professionally done, but it's still the same barrel cut up. And another charred old barrel, you see. So this is just a lid. I've given it a medium char, put some holes in it. You get a good surface area for the liquor. Now one of these should do 5 litres of liquor. So I'm going to pop one of these inside the demijohn with the liquor. I'm going to age it now. Your filtering options, you can buy. I've got some in the cupboard. I've not got it out for the video, I'm sorry. It's a bag of activated charcoals. Make sure it's food grade. But not the ones for fish tanks. Food grade activated charcoal, that's fine. You can get one of these, which is what I've got. It's a rip-off Brita water filter, cheap as chips. It'll do the job just fine. Remember to always aim higher. Whatever your desired proof alcohol is, I usually drink this at 40, so because it's more palatable for me. I know people drink it at 50, 55. I can't handle it that big. I'm not that big of a drinker, but 50-55 if you want it that. Just knock it down to whatever proof you want. So we'll just pour it in here like this. But we're going to try to do it one handed. I've blended my jars together. I'll show you what the tails look like. Tails. I started getting tails at jar 14. I don't know if you can see that, but it's kind of like you get a few. It goes cloudy anyway, like jar 17. I collected these for my next one. That's really cloudy. Yeah, jar 13 was okay, which is why we do the small cuts on here. It's why we go from big jars to little jars. It's why on here. Well, if I show you my cuts was coming off, that's what the percentage was when it was coming off. It started off at 89, and as you go along, the percentage will drop, and the less percentage you have, the more flavour you have. So which is why we blend the cuts together. Pardon me. We blend the cuts together. We get a big jug full like this, and then I'm going to age that. If you want to filter it, that's fine. I think Jack Daniel's carbon filter it once. Gentleman's Jack Daniel's, filter it before it goes into the barrel, and then once afterwards, if you want to do that, whatever process you use. But we've got 3 litres. I've got an app here on my phone, and it does all the calculations for you. So if we've got 3,000 millilitres
of liquor here at 59%. My desired proof would be 40. Initial desired proof, initial proof is 59, just there, you click calculate. And it's not working, 1 minute. There we go. I put it in there. Starting proof, I did it wrong. I put the initial volume as the starting proof. Starting proof is 59. Desired proof is 40. Initial volume is 3,000 millilitres. And it'll tell you there, add water, 1,421 millilitres, that's 1.4 litres, and you'll have 4.4 litres of smooth drinkable moonshine. And like I said, if you age it with that, you'll get a really nice amber colour. Now, the reason why I call this Jar 9 Shine is because Jar 9 is the smoothest, the best smelling in the bunch, the best smelling, the smoothest liquor, predominantly corn. You get a nice taste of barley and an after kick of rye, a real bite to it. It's really nice. Now that is 59%. Now I will drink that at that proof, because it's so smooth, you don't get no alcohol burn off that. It's really nice. Now I'll drink that as a moonshine out of the mason jar, and this I'm going to age with one of these, which I wouldn't mind trying it. I've never done it with one of these before. I tried to buy some off eBay, but unfortunately they wouldn't come. You can get them professionally made, but I had another spare barrel. I used one for the thumper. I had a small 2 litre one, which I didn't like. I don't personally like the barrels, so I cut the lid down, and it's not pretty, but it works. I tried it myself with a brulee thing, you know, and burner things. You can get like a mini blowtorch for brulees. Now, so yeah, I'm knocking this down to 44%. Now I'm going to use still water for this, mineral water, because it's going to be 60% of your drink, isn't it? So you want to use the best water. You don't want to use tap water, because it just won't be nice at all. Use really good water to mix in with this, and it'll come up to about here, and I'll age it, and I'll put the bung in, and I'll put it somewhere nice. Now, the thing is with these water filters and activated charcoal filters is it does retain some of the alcohol. So if you're filtering it through a water filter, once you've activated it with a bit of water, if your desired proof is 40, like me, aim for, put it through the carbon filter at 50 or 45, because you can always add more water, you can never take it out. If you knock it down too much, you'll be drinking a really weak 30% drink. It won't be nice, you won't enjoy it. So yeah, and when you finish filtering, because it retains some liquid, put about 100 mils worth of water, of this water, in after you've finished filtering, because it'll just push the remaining liquor out of the cartridge, and you'll get a bit of water in there, which will dilute your liquor at the end of it, which is why we put it through there at say 44%, 45%, and then the little bit of liquor will knock it down to about 42. And like I said, get yourself one of these. It's a spirit hydrometer. It'll tell you how much it is. But yeah, that's 59% we got off there. 3 litres, 59%. That's a good run for me. I drink this myself. 4 litres of whiskey will last me an absolute bloody ages. I'm not stilled for over 12 months because I've literally not run out of whiskey. I'm going to do a George Washington rye whiskey. I've got the recipe offline. I'm reading it everywhere. It's meant to be nice. If you guys want me to do any more recipes or anything like that, if you've got any questions, give us a shout in the comment box. I'll be happy to help. If I've missed anything and you think you can tell me I missed it, then by all means say. I don't think I've missed anything out. Everything seems... So have a quick think. The only thing I'm thinking about is because you've got more surface area to liquor and wood, you know, if I put that in the barrel, because my barrel was 5 litres, it's fine. You could leave that 12 months, it'll come out
a really nice, because it's all the same batch, you could call it a straight bourbon. This is what bourbon looks like before it goes in the barrel. You know, this is American White Oak. It's from an American White Oak barrel. We just drilled it a bit, cut it with a jigsaw, not very neatly, but it's all sanded down so there's no bits coming off that. And I charred it medium char because you get a nice vanilla flavours coming off that. You'll still retain the corn, barley and rye. And like I said, Gentleman's Jack, which is the, pardon me, my voice is still going. Gentleman's Jack, which is the light years ahead of Jack Daniel's number 7. It goes through a charcoal filter before the barrel, and it goes in the barrel. Then it comes out the barrel, it goes in the filter for a second filter, then to the bottle. That's why it's smoother. If you want to do that, you can filter it 100 times if you want to. It will take out impurities in the alcohol, make it a lot more smoother. I might do it, I might not do it. I'm not decided yet. What I'll do is I'll knock this down to 40%. I'll taste it. And with the cuts, the reason I did 33, 66 and 99 equals jar 1 at 150 mils, because the 4 shots, very importantly, first bit of alcohol that comes off the still is methanol. That's really poisonous for you. Don't drink it, you'll go blind and you'll die. It's not worth it. For a 25 litre still like mine, it says you should take off 50 mils. I think that might be just over 2 ounces if you work out in ounces, but it's 50 millilitres. As you can see now, I take off 150 and I put that in one of these jars. I use that for domestic cleaning. If you look, it's just an old jar of tomato puree. Do not drink that, you'll be really stupid if you did. I don't even take a reading of that. I don't let any of my equipment touch this. It just goes straight into the jar, 150 mils, which I've marked on there with nail polish. And the heads, I always take off 190 mils for the heads, because it smells of acetone. If you don't know what acetone smells like, then go and buy some acetone nail polish remover. Get used to the smell, get your nose ready for the smell so you can pick it up in this. And experience and your nose will help you. I put that in a heads jar. I don't use that. That just stays to one side for cleaning. If you've got Sharpie pens, permanent markers, perfect for an app. Dip a bit of in kitchen roll, kitchen cloth, and scrub it off. Perfect, no worries. Now, like I said, write down everything you do. 100 mils, 150, because I make small cuts to the start with, then big cuts in the middle where the hearts are, then little cuts towards the end, because I've got a start of the tails in jar 14. Now your run might be completely different to mine, depending on how much alcohol you start off with. Everything's different, so write it down. This is just what I do. This is just my run. My run will be totally different to yours, so don't carbon copy it, because you'll be saying, oh, it's gone different for me. It will go different for you, because you're doing a different run to me. This is just use it as a guideline, if you will. Use it how to make cuts. Now I'm not telling you what I blended in together, because that's just for my little secret. But yeah, get used to the smell of acetone. If you don't like it, don't put it in. All the bad stuff's gone in here. Literally overkill. You know, that's 204. That's, God, my brain's not woke up yet. That's 340 mils of liquid there, which just goes straight down the drains. If you don't want it, use it for domestic cleaning by all means. Toss it out, throw it away, don't drink that stuff. First 50 mils has the methanol, so we're definitely safe with this. 340 mils is definitely overkill. You can never be too safe in this game. I'm always safe, and overkill is the best way to go. So, as I was saying, take small cuts to begin with, larger cuts in the middle, small cuts at the end, because if you got this, which is jar 17, which is tails, which I collect a big lot. It's all cloudy. If you put one of these into this, it'll turn it all cloudy and you've wrecked your batch. You can redistill it, that's fine. The alcohol is still usable, but you don't want to be drinking cloudy whiskey. You know, you don't want that. Like I said, my tails started at 14, yours might start at 10, yours might start at 18. always make small cuts towards the end and the beginning, because if you'd have put the acetone flavour in your heads into your batch, the whole lot's going to smell of acetone. It's not going to be a desirable whiskey. What you want to make here is a sipping whiskey, and this is, I'll sit out in the sun with this and I'll have, just sip it and you'll have a really good afternoon. Excellent, you know. And I hope I've helped you out, guys. Like I said, this is just what I do. It might contradict what you do, but I'll assure you this is correct for me. This, I'm doing everything safe. This is just what I do. I'm not saying everyone else is wrong. There is no wrong way about it. If you take out your poisonous stuff like that, you take out your tails, which is your fusel alcohols, oils, whatever you want to call them, you're safe. You can have a really good hobby. Don't let anyone tell you you're doing this wrong, you're doing that wrong. As long as you're staying away from heavy metals like cheap steel, lead, solder, anything like that, you know, don't do it. Stay away from it, as we talked about in another video. Like I said, you can have fun with it. I bought a barrel, didn't like it myself, so I'm going to try these now, see if it goes. Now, I've got some of these for the barbecue. I have done this in the past, but I didn't like these either. This is smoking chips. This is Jim Beam's wood chips. Now, I use these for the barbecue. If you look here, get you some out there, charred, and they're just crushed up bits of wood. It's American White Oak. If you want to wash these off, and I don't know where they've been, they just go in the barbecue for me when I'm smoking food. if you want to wash them off and then dump them in there, I think it's 100 grams of wood per 5 litres of alcohol. I've done that before. You'll get a nice oak flavour and a nice taste. That'll flavour your whiskey. Perfect. Now, you can get them essences, as we talked about in another video. I stay away from those. That's the only bit of advice I'll tell you what to do. Stay away from those. They are a complete... They're disgusting. They're horrible. If you buy one for about £3, just buy one, have a smell of it, because they're just not very good, and you'll understand when you smell them. These flavour essences, and they'll tell you it tastes like rye whiskey, Jack Daniels. They don't, they just taste like crap. They really are, but not good. Like I said, you've got all your flavour in your whiskey itself. You've got your corn, barley and rye there, which is just amazing to drink. That's why I call this Jar 9 Shine, because Jar 9 is my favourite. It comes off the still. You can drink that straight off the still. I wouldn't advise it while you're stilling. Try not to drink it when you're stilling. You want the clear head. Stay safe, guys. Like I said, you've got all your flavour in your liquor. You want to add flavour. That's what I'm doing. You want to get a white oak barrel. Perfect. Do it. You mess around with it however you want. Your taste buds are different to mine. Your nose is different to mine. I've been doing this for many, many years. I've got used to the smells, experience is key in this game. The more experience you've got, the better it is for you. As long as you toss this out, like I said, your heads, you want to play around with that. Take less out, 150, 100, you want to play around with that, that's fine. Just do it in small incremental cuts. Sorry, I don't know what the word is, can't pronounce it, my throat's killing me today. Do it in small cuts there, like that. Just cut it and cut it and cut it. You can't, these jars are cheap, you know. Just do it in small cuts, because you get any of this in your alcohol, it's just going to make it really bad to drink. It's not going to be nice. You don't want to drink acetone. It just smells terrible. It's not something you want to be drinking. I'm pretty certain it's poisonous. I wouldn't want to drink it myself, you know. But yeah, 4 shots. That's the first bit off the still. 50 mils for a 25 litre still. I took off 150, that's 3 times as much, plus I took off an extra 190. So altogether, the first 340 mils off the still I use for domestic cleaning. And like I said, you can do that different, but minimum here is 50 mils. Throw that out, don't play around with that. I take off 150, it isn't worth it. You could make 3 50 mil cuts of that if you like, and have a smell of it, so you get used to the smell. But please throw the first 50 mils away per 25 litre wash. It's not worth it. Just throw it away. That'll just poison you. You will kill yourself. You will go blind. Your eyes aren't worth whiskey. This is a hobby at the end of the day. don't be silly, stay safe, throw the first 50 mils away, smell it by all means, get three glass jars, take it in increments. You want to mess about with this is just what I do, this is what I've done for many years. I can do this by thumb now. My rule of thumb is I just do this because I know that that's with my recipe, with the amount of alcohol that I have in my wash, I think it was 10%, with the alcohol that goes into the thumper, I think it was 49% or something like that. I know what's going to come off when, because I've been doing it so long. You'll just get used to it, experience. Like I said, you want to experiment with these, then get smaller cutting vessels, smell them, don't taste them, smell them. Whatever you do, don't taste them, just smell them, get used to the smell. This you can do the same. Pardon me. Get smaller jars, cut it 50 mil cuts. As you can see with the video of the still, it just flies off the still pretty fast. You're doing it properly, it'll come off real good. Cut it into 50 mils, get used to the smell, so the first 50 mils, smell it, don't taste it, smell, get used to the smells, and when you're used to the smells of the heads, you'll be able to identify the heads in these. Now, like I said, I'm not going to tell you what I've blended into this, because that's just what my little secret I'm going to keep to myself. But like I said, all these are safe. That's the horrible bits. You can get trace heads in them. This is the recipe I do to make sure that I don't get the heads in there. I don't like the taste of the heads. I don't like the taste of the tails. The tails to me smell like wet dog. If you've got a dog and it's had a bath, or it's been out in the rain, and it just smells like wet dog, not very nice. You don't want that in your liquor. This is just what I've done. You can copy me by all means, that's fine. If you want to help, give us a shout, I don't mind helping. And like I said, this is just what I've done and what I've blended together. And if you do this, if you get experience with your nose, you'll be able to tell which one of these, because sometimes that can have heads in, because that's first off, that can sometimes have heads in. It's just this recipe didn't have them in this time, but it can have them in, heads in that and that, and that'll go into jar one. So if it's got heads in that one, toss them aside, keep this one for jar one, it's fine. If that one's clear, that's clear and that's clear, put them into jar one. If that's got heads in, that's not and that's not, then just put these two 50 mils into jar one. But I'll guarantee you by jar two, it's the sweetest smelling whiskey you've ever smelled, straight off the still. And like I said, the percentage will go down every 100 mils you collect. It took me many years to find out how many mils to cut. I was making cut after cut after cut after cut after cut just to make sure I didn't get the heads and the tails, and to make sure I got the hearts. This is just experience talking to me. Like I said, write it down. So you make a really good whiskey. What to cut, what to put in it. You'll have a jar like that you can sit out and really enjoy, and you don't have to put any flavour enhanced crap in that, because it'll just, you've got all the flavour in there. And that's a traditional moonshine whiskey. And like I said, if you want me to do any recipes or anything like that, give us a shout. If it interests me, if it piques my interest, I'll be happy to try it. I'm always happy to do new recipes. But your cuts are pretty much the same in every recipe you do. Sorry, your cuts, the way you cut it is the same, but the percentage, depending on your wash, if you've got more alcohol in the wash, I didn't have that much in it, 10, you can have up to 22, you can even have 22% in your washes these days with your turbo yeast. I didn't want to do that. I didn't want a shitload of whiskey to drink. I'll never drink it all. I drink this for myself. So that's why I only did 10% in the wash. Your cuts, the way you do your cuts are the same, but your percentage will always change, because depending on what you've got in the wash and what you've got in your thumper, the outcome will be different on that. So yeah, get used to the smells, experience talking here, chuck that crap away, not worth it. Have a play around with that, see what you think with that. I didn't like it, I chucked it away, not worth it. As long as those are away, everything else is fair game. That's the poison. Everything else is fair game. Have a play with it. Have a taste of it. Have a smell of it. Have a touch of it as well. Put it in between your fingers. use all your senses here: sight, taste, touch. So use them all as much as you can, anything that can help you. Like I said, you want to follow my recipe, by all means do so, that's fine. You have any problems, give me a shout, I'll help as much as I can. But this is where the real science is, cutting it. That's where the master distillery business comes in, that's where experience talks, that's where making the whiskey comes into it, cutting it. Because you make the right cuts, you'll make the right whiskey. You make the wrong cuts, put that crap in it, be fine to drink, you're not do yourself any harm, you're not kill yourself, but you don't want cloudy whiskey, you know. So make small cuts, get used to it, build your experience up. Then when your experience grows, you'll know what different smells smell like. You'll be able to make larger cuts like I have there. Like I said, do you have any questions, put them in the comment box. If I remember to do so, I'll put this in for about 3 months. I can come back and do another video. I'll put that on a separate video, see what that looks like. Depending on the feedback I get from this video, if you guys like the video, give us a thumbs up, I'd appreciate that. Like I said, I don't make videos like this, my first video on YouTube. Sorry if my directing skills are a bit off, and sorry if my audio is gone at times. I do apologise for that. Like I said, good ingredients going in, good whiskey coming out. I just wish you could smell it and taste it. It's awesome. Thank you very much, guys. And give us a, like I said, if you liked the video, give us a thumbs up. If you've got any questions, put them in the comment box.